without further ado, I want to introduce Robert Cooksey. He is the RealSense Design Lead for the Intel Perceptual Computing Group. And in this role, he serves as a UX designer developer, experimenting with relationship among people, sensors, networks, and devices, while supporting external developers and design expertise in the field of sensing machines. And he's also one of the founding professors for Ringling College of Art and Design. So please welcome Robert Cooksey.
So I'm going to do this fast, a little faster than I'm used tonight, apropos to the subject matter. So if I touch on something that's interesting, or you have a question about it, or a comment, or something that kind of lead us a little deeper, feel free to touch on that. I'm going to let us wander. I've got a bunch of material. I'd never cover all of it anyway. So I'd rather kind of cover the space that's interesting for us to explore. First off, I'd like to introduce myself a little bit. My history is kind of a lot. Training is all in philosophy, mostly. History, it took me about 10 years to get an undergraduate degree because I studied everything until I ended up with a degree. And then fast tracks with philosophy in grad school. During that time, of course, there's not a lot of jobs for philosophers, but I was personal computing was growing, and so I began to touch the machines and use them a lot and help folks in labs and create new projects, and I discovered that logic could be a tool other than analysis. I could use it for synthesis. And began to repurpose that. And that became kind of the theme of a lot of the work I do is repurposing old tools for new purposes. Changing inputs and outputs. Taking something that was intended to be a tool of analysis and turning it into a tool for production. Taking a tool for production and turning it into a tool of analysis. Flipping those around and seeing what we might be able to learn. A lot of the techniques are good, we just need to find out what we can do with them in different spaces. Along the way, I started off doing a lot of web work early on, getting the idea of what a web portal would be. Right? People at universities and institutions, they had all these disparate systems that were monitoring information and doing lots of work on in terms of just registering a system here, or a business system here, or a tracking system there. And we decided we were going to unify those. So I did a lot of work early on trying to understand what it would mean to create a unified front that would hide all of the gears behind that. So a lot of my early work was in that technology. And through that, I became interested in interface design and interaction design, and that led me to games. So I was thinking a lot about games for a long time, particularly in terms of world building and interaction design in games. And that led eventually to Ringling, which Raj mentioned, and they recruited me to help build a program there for what the future of game art design would look like. If you were going to build designers for games that were storytelling, what would that look like? At that point, I really wanted to do good programs for that. And Ringling has a fantastic, world-renowned animation program. In my time there, I stopped counting when I had about 24 Oscar winners as former students. So you know, with for a while to keep track of them. I got another 2, we got 3 this year, just gonna quit. They were so good at producing fantastic animators, then that became the norm, which put the weight on me when I was building another program in that department to make the game program as good as that. And the process became decomposing really what the problem set was. And at that point, people were trying to make good games, but what we were thinking is maybe the games we want to make aren't the games that exist. We should train people to make the games that aren't going to exist if we don't make people who can make them. And so we began to try to build that program, whatever that would be. In my time there, I learned a little bit, I had some contacts, and then Intel recruited me and asked me to come out and check out what they were doing. At that point, it was only Perceptual Computing, RealSense, didn't exist yet as a brand. And I was skeptical that Intel was doing anything that I might be interested in because of where I was and what I was doing. And I walked into the lab and I couldn't get it out of my mind. I went home, I was back in class, and I couldn't stop thinking about what we could do if machines could sense. We've done a really good job of making machines process really nicely and fast and be smart, be able to process information really rapidly and communicate with each other. Adding senses was a game changer. I couldn't stop thinking about what can I do with that? And a lot of what had brought me to games was environments, thinking about how environments could be intelligent storytelling. And began to think, what could happen if we did that in the real world? So what if I could make this space know itself and understand itself and have triggers like I have in games that for behaviors for particular situations or contexts? And this sensing that until we began to get into offered me the opportunity to really begin to explore it. In the early days, we had no idea what we were going to do. When I came into the curriculum later, kind of headed out toward working with a lot of PC stuff, so things, you know, where we get to put these cameras, 3D sensing cameras facing users in laptops and PCs, and now we're going to tablets, and now we're looking at what future computing spaces is today. So it could be anything from robots to drones to buildings to cars to toys to, you know, anything that we might put computing, and since computing is getting smaller, that could be almost anything. That's kind of where what led me to where. Along the way, there were a lot of questions that came up that were unanswered, and we had a lot of challenges that we didn't know how to deal with. And the people I worked with were a nice range of skill sets. And that's one of the things I want to get to today is thinking about how did the group of people that worked on this sort of thing kind of come together? And it wasn't new. I noticed in games too. I noticed when we worked in cultural spaces, everybody was coming with these backgrounds. There was nobody who was trained to do this because there wasn't this to be trained to do. There were no rules. There were no guidelines. There was no rule of thirds. We didn't have these rules of thumb yet. And so the reason I chose the topic, designing in unthought spaces, it's largely because those spaces, I think, are the spaces that a lot of us work in every day. And we're always looking for tools, but we don't really have a way of talking about it so much with each other. And I think it would be helpful for something, for those of us who work in the space, to really think about what we're engaged in, to open that. So first I want to talk about design. So when I say design, I'm very simple with design. I use design as a very general term. When I think of design, what I think of is I have a goal B that I want to reach, and the situation is A. Somehow we need to get to B from A. So the first challenge is understanding where we want to go. And the second challenge is understanding where we are. And if we fail at either of those, everything in between is going to be a miss. Right? So that's the first challenge. It's that in general design. When I talk about designing in unthought spaces, we have another challenge, which is we might not know where we want to go. So we have something that shows up, an opportunity. And that opportunity is promising, exciting, full of energy, we really want to go do it. We have no idea what this is going to be. What can we do here? And the number of times I've been asked in the last 3 years, what would you do with X? That's the constraint. Here's the step. What would you do with it? What would I do with it where? What would I do under what context? With what user? Under what situation? All these questions that we think of when you're in design, you're trying to limit your user space, your constraints, you're trying to find out what exactly is the problem I'm solving so I nail this just right. None of that's there. You don't have any. Just kind of like, well, I need to decide enough. I need to create my own constraints. And that becomes a form of design in itself. And that's one of the things that we're going to get at. And I just kind of have ways of doing that. So, first off, when we don't have these rules of thumbs, we kind of have to start becoming explorers again. So, I think, you know, most of us have had education and experience in different jobs, and we kind of acquire nice new toolkits we take with us, right? So, you know, if somebody asks me to do a graph, you know, if you're going to build design an app interface, okay, cool, I've got a whole set of tool sets right now. I can limit down this. I know I'm going to be managing some screens. I'm going to have some kind of touch interface, probably. There's lots of like little, and I can use these suites of interactions. I can, so people know this interaction. People know this interaction. I'm working in film, I know that I'm going to move the camera this way because it's going to give this feeling when I do so. If I cut this way, it's going to feel a certain way. If I fade, it's going to communicate time differently. So we go to these spaces where we don't have those rules, we don't have a rule. But we do have all these things, and all the people are already creating. So we may not know B yet, we kind of don't know A, because we don't know what's going to work. But we do know what has been different. That's something. That's a place to start. I think often it's very easy for us to end up in a place where you want to throw your hands up with, I don't have anything here. It's not that we don't have anything. It's just that we don't have everything. He wasn't avant-garde. There was avant-garde art going on at the same time John Cage was creating. He wasn't an avant-garde artist. He can tell you he wasn't an avant-garde artist. He was an experimental artist. He composed a piece that was silence. It wasn't because that was the piece that he intended, that this is, you know, I'm trying to achieve something, I'm making a statement. It was an experiment. What's going to happen to the audience? What's it going to sound like? How's the audience going to react when there's no sound and yet a performance? What's going to happen there? So for him, this was an opportunity to really understand deeply what the negative space in music was. And it worked. He used it in much of the future and many artists after in music. I think we need to kind of take a cue from that. Think about design when we're starting to work. You know, we always talk about like, fail early, fail often. Sometimes we think we need to do that with design, but to take a step back even further and fail at even the techniques of design. I think a great example of a team that did this was Valve, the game company Valve. And they made Left 4 Dead, which is kind of a team, it's a pretty weird zombie team game. But they wanted it to be real, to people to work together. They wanted to force people to work together, but not in a way that stronger. They wanted to choose to work together. That's a pretty strange design answer. How do I make four people work together as if they're a team, even if they've never met each other, and they're meeting online and they're going the second day? And so what they did was they balanced the entire game to four players so that if any one player drops out or dies, you lose. Everyone dies. It's impossible to finish with three. That was the first thing. The second thing they did is they wanted to build a sense of compassion between the players. And normally what we would do, so they created this thing, where they put a film, they put one healing unit. So I get a backpack on and I can heal myself or another player. I have to choose it, which I how I can use it. So I hold on to it for myself. But if that player's in danger and it goes down, that means we're all going to work. Now I have to choose to take this pack off my back and use it to help this guy, which means if I'm hurt, I just have to play hurt for now and have to accept that. Pretty cool idea for the balance. The problem they ran into was they tried to film it like we were filming the film. So you're all in first person, fall down, and we're looking at it in first person. Normally in film, that's what you would do. You're going to see what's going on. It's a straight line. You know, if I want an intense moment, two people next to each other, put a camera between them, and another one out here looking at both of them, and then I never use the second. The distance we always think of, the distance to the camera, that's the distance of the emotion. Going that tight. That's why we're always at a distance from the comedy. We laugh, because we're getting off emotional distance. So they tried it. They tried to have the camera right between the players, right next to the game. It didn't work. Nobody was hitting it, it was confusing, it didn't feel right. So what they did is they moved the camera, it swiveled all the way out. The only time the camera's not first person is flat. You shoot comedy, looking at both players, looking at one view of the player, healing the other person in this pack, and that person getting up. And it worked. I mean, violating all of our rules. Like what we think were our rules in international film. And that's the first point I want to get to about the approach to doing this stuff, is that our rules are not rules. They're techniques. So we have to bring that back in the film started, nobody knew how to communicate that. We're looking at my hand, there's something in my hand. And I'm looking at my hand, and the cut shows the hand cut back to the eyes and all the other things. Somebody had to invent that. That was a montage. Right? Now it's just a technique. It's a rule, we'll say. But we do that all the time. A lot of the rules we use, when we move into new spaces, those rules change. And it's really important, I think, for those of us that are working in spaces that are non-traditional, and might not have the same kind of interfaces, to remember that when the constraints change, so does everything else. So some way we need to experiment with our old techniques and see if they work. And there's lots of ways of doing that. We've talked a little bit about some of these spaces that we're working in now. So what Raj mentioned tonight, I would talk about user space where there isn't a user. Kind of right. It's a little different, I think. Sometimes we're thinking about it not so much that there isn't a user, so much as the user might not be a person. So a simple example of that is, say you're designing a small device, an IoT device, that dispenses treats for your pet. the user is the dog. Like, this is what we're trying to communicate. So you might be designing for a dog user. And that seems like a simple case at first. But then if we started, when we started working with sensing spaces, when we started broadening out what we're doing with sensing machines, say I fill this space with cameras. The camera, this whole space understands itself in three dimensions. It understands what its history is. It understands what's been here for a while and what might be here tomorrow from that distance, or what's temporary. You know, the fact that these chairs are arranged this way, or that which chairs are occupied, how many people are here, or where they are, when they are. But all of that is data that can be parsed and understood in different ways. What if a robot came in and navigated this? If that data was communicating, was gathering and understanding itself, but the robot was going to use that data in order to pathfind, the robot may not be part of this system. This infrastructure may be completely independent from what the robot does, thinks, intends. The robot has its own intentions, its own actor. It might be a cleanup robot. So in a simple case, its job is to come here and clean up. So it may not be part of that system, but it's using that system. So at that point, we need to start thinking, what are the intentions of an intentional actor that isn't a human? And so we have to design systems that would communicate an interface to the robot, in which case the screen doesn't really help. The robot doesn't want a screen. It wants a data patched to it in a way that's comprehensible, understandable, and usable. It's, if want is a term that we use for robots. We write a persona for a robot like that. This robot wants to blood. So that's one case. But there may be many. There might be human users that use the same system. So maybe that same system has three or four interfaces, all different kinds of users. Some of them are vehicles. Some of them are robots. Some of them are drones. Some of them are humans. Some of them are cell phones. They all are different. You want that information in a different way that are usable to the kinds of things that they intend to do for whatever that functionality is we're designing for. And when I say whatever that functionality is designing for, we still have no idea what B is going to be for us. So that's up to us too. Let's design what B is going to be, that place we're going to go. When we're doing that, I think it's really important to kind of come back to our previous techniques. Really, nothing is lost. When I was a professor, one of my favorite things to hear students say was, this is useless to me. Like, well, I did all this work, and then we're not even using it. You're not using it for this project, but perhaps it's not useful. So perhaps learning a set of techniques that are useful to you when you need them is part of the learning process. And I think that's part of all of our learning processes. It's really important to remember when you're working in unthought spaces. That when you come in, things you've learned that may not even be part of your profession are useful to you. Things that you might have done, helped your dad wire together, install a light switch somewhere when you're 12 years old. And you remember something about the wiring of that light switch and the way light switches work. That may come back to you when you're working on a product interface and realize, that's exactly what I need right now. Right now, that simple thing that I put in a box somewhere and forgot about, that's the thing that's useful to me. Or remembering that we're noticing that, for instance, all the buttons in your car are tactile. We always talk about screens, looking at screens all the time. Do I really want to look at a screen when I'm driving a car? It might not be the safest thing to do while I'm driving, right? But if it's tactile, I can feel it without looking. Then I get feedback, I get data, I can explore it, I can sense and kind of interact in a way that's really useful. But take that outside the car. That might be useful somewhere else. We designed a project one time. We did a super project we worked on the side because nobody would afford us to do it. We're convinced. I saw some research that was done by a guy at the University of Chicago. We're playing with sonar, trying to feel the shape of the space using sonar. The problem is sonar's moving. Right? It bounces. If I have four sonar, they all bounce back. That's amazing. You can't separate the signals. But at this point, we had a functional camera. RealSense. The camera's got pretty good range. It doesn't muddy its own signals. You can put up two of them. It's not a problem. So we started experimenting with more. Can I feel the shape of the space? How would you do that? So the challenge became, we decided to set set a goal for B. We needed a clear B that we could tackle. We knew what we had. We knew where we wanted to go. And that B became, we want to be able to navigate a cluttered space blindfolded. We want to walk around a cluttered space and navigate that space with no sight whatsoever. So, how do we do that? Screens aren't going to work, you can't see, so no guidance there. So what we ended up with is haptic controls. So a little vibration movement we put on the body, and the camera would light up the space and get feedback. So this was a pretty cool little innovation that allows us to show up showing at CES 2015 as part of the keynote. But another part of the keynote that I think is really interesting in relation to that was there was a drone in that same keynote. So Brian, who's an amateur CEO, was demoing this. He showed our blind navigation system, which is really rudimentary exploration. And people could feel the gradients and how far things were away. It was a few pixels. They could feel the shape of the space and navigate. In that same keynote, a drone was given a GPS location. It navigated from point A to point B. Then it avoided obstacles that could be moved as it did so. The funny thing is, it's the same technique. Both of them were just taking the space, dividing it in distance measures, and then determining how to move based upon what things were approximate to what it was trying to do. I'm trying to move from point A to point B. This thing's in the way, I'm moving. With the drone, it had a small compute cycle it was doing. For our system, it was a human. We gave information human could use, and the human made the decisions and plotted the system. So the techniques were very similar, but they were used in completely disparate spaces. And this is, I think, really gold for us. This is when we start working in these unthought spaces, we should build it. If we get a breakthrough anywhere, it's a breakthrough everywhere. Because those are new techniques that we can bring into our libraries and really cool stuff. We can start using it anywhere, so now we can start to say, this is a technique. We can talk about, it's not just this thing that this one drone did once. It's not this one tool or this one product that was made that had one kind of technique for navigation. It becomes a technique for navigation. And anybody who uses any navigation at that point, and they need to avoid obstacles or identify near field objects, so now we can use it. And sometimes it might be used for attraction. Sometimes it might be used for avoidance. The funny thing is, for us, we kept thinking avoidance. But we would use the term, actually, obstacle avoidance. And then one day, we were testing. And one of our users was blind since he was a very small child. And he kept doing this. Walking up, touching things. It's a funny thing. One of the licensing services said, are you purposely walking into the obstacles? And he goes, oh. I didn't think of them as obstacles. I thought of them as they might be something interesting. Okay. We've been putting this entire technique we developed into a little box. One way it might be used. And we realized that for someone who can't sense the room, there is no room, there is no object outside the distance of his hand. It doesn't exist. So if there's something that he senses is out there, he can actually find it. So it's not just obstacles. Avoidance. It's actually obstacle detection, or not obstacle detection, but object detection. It begins to kind of unfold the space. And this is where we go. We can begin to take our old techniques and adapt them, but we can also take our new techniques and adapt them. We have to kind of pull our brakes off the wheel. And I think it's, I can't stress how hard it is to do this. So many of us are under pressure for production. Everybody in this room knows what that feels like. Right? We're always working on a timeline. But sometimes we're working on a timeline, but it isn't happening. We're always looking at what the step is right in front of us. And we never step back and see what's the problem we're actually trying to solve. What's the opportunity or the experience we're actually trying to create? We think we're on the right path, but we may be wandering the path that's leading us away from the experience we're targeting on, because now we're on a deadline, we've got to work. So it's really important to take a step back and look at the techniques we're using and say, is this the right technique? And I have a really good example of this for actually something that happened to us. Is we ran into a problem with a game that I was supposedly designing the game that we were making. And we had a particular limitation with chain. We didn't realize it. We were doing hand detection and working with things that with the game when these kids could do things with their hands that would reach out and do things. But what we didn't think about is the kids had very small not a lot of pixel space to analyze when a kid lifts his hand. A kid moves very quickly. Much more quickly than adults would. It doesn't seem to actually way faster. So it's just to the brain problems. We're so careful, we have limited all this time. We're only gonna do two features that were really intense, and we constrained ourselves every way possible, did everything we thought was the right thing to do. Here we were in a situation where we might have to cut a core feature that was one of only two features we really burned, like really nailed in the game. So we're stuck in it. I remember sitting in meetings where we were tense, it was really tense. And at one point we realized, I'm looking at it, and I thought, I kept watching people test as they were doing it, or trying this out. I just couldn't do that. I was looking at the screen, and I realized, when I raise my hand, the camera sees the screen. There's more pixel weight on that side of the screen than there is that side of the screen. Right? If I know the distance, and I just say, grab me the thing in the foreground, some of the cool things we can do when we know how far something is from the screen, right? Because they grab the foreground and get rid of everything else. There's more pixels on this side than that side. So maybe I don't need anything. Maybe I just need to know where all the weight is. So we tried it out. And capturing about 90% of our faces immediately was faster than everything else we've ever tried. It worked for this case, it wouldn't work for a lot of really still really fine finger. It worked great for this case. The problem we ran into is sometimes kids get excited and they mean. So now I've got a head on the side of the screen. Luckily, we had some clever engineers there. The engineers said, well, the hand and the head are pretty clearly subdivided. So maybe we just divide those pixels into two groups. It takes that blob that we already set and just took away from the background. Separate it again. And because what can you do is that the hand can never go behind the head. And if it's behind the head, it's very uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable to do this. Nobody's doing this, right? It's kind of, this is, actually, if you do jiu-jitsu, this is a way to get someone to tap. It's very uncomfortable. Not good for the shoulder. So, if you look at the forward one, and somebody can look at the forward, sit back and say, what are we really trying to demonstrate? What are we really trying to do? We don't need that technique. We just need everybody that does that. And in the process, a couple of people thinking differently. Think about the shoulder. Think about that. You have to think about the hand being in front of the shoulder. How often do you really need to do that? But in this kind of thing, we do. Suddenly that matters. So those of us who might have done some kind of sport, you do yoga, you do any kind of physical activity where you have to train your body to move in particular ways. Start realizing that's actually useful to you here. But when you start trying to teach people to do gesture, you realize if you raise your hand above your shoulder, that gets tired pretty quickly. The problem is we had all these developers who were just really so excited about what we could do, and you move your hands everywhere. You get tired, you want to put your arms down, grow on, you know, maybe it helps grow on. But so just, but this is pretty comfortable. Rest my elbow here, it's in front. But then we have to think about arcs. If I move flat, that's hard. If I try to move in a flat plane, it's really hard. If I move in an arc, that's pretty nice. So let's talk about that. Let's think about those kinds of things. So all of these techniques that we started developing were things that were, oh, well, animation has a lot of tools about how creatures move in arcs. Let's just go dig all that stuff up. Let's look at the way, like, using arcs. Let's look at, like, kind of slight bends. These not being, they call us paddle hands in animation. So if you have a character that ever looks like this, they make fun of it, right? They call it paddle hands. And we realized we were requiring people to do this when we were playing out with our early prototypes. We make people do this. That's exhausting. It hurts to stretch your fingers out perfectly straight. That's pretty comfortable. So that's an overhead. Not that. That could be. These little things that we start to, as we kind of develop these things, we're just exploring the unknown. Like, and seeing, like, well, what's broken, what are we trying to do? Does anybody have anything on this? And so we end up looking at animation, we end up looking at our own bodies, we're just experimenting with ourselves. What's tiring? What's not tiring? So, come back to general idea of this approach is when we're doing all this design work here, one of the things I think both the electrical example and the electrical example, the game example, it illustrates is that we have to be ready to change all the time. And I think that's something we embrace in the history of design pretty strongly, right? We're always, at least the good programs, teach you should be always ready to kill your babies, right? Like, practice it. Make something and then kill it. Make something and then kill it. Get in the habit of not connecting, not attaching to an idea, not holding on to it too tightly. Because we stop looking at what the problem is, we start looking at what the thing we made is and trying to save the thing we made. Right? Well, that's the thing. We have to keep it alive. It's a really precious thing. Like, you know, we don't want to be gods. Right? We don't want to have our own pressures that we're working our entire life with. And in doing that, I think we can develop a practice of what I call ad hoc design, where we're changing the process all the way. But when we're designing in unthought spaces, sometimes that means changing the B2. You know, the destination we're going to, we might need to change it in B2s. Like we're on the way, and we realize that thing's not going to work. We need to make something else out of it. And that is, sometimes like, giving up your little thing is hard. Changing the path is hard. Really, it's hard. It's expensive. We all work in organizations where turning the boat is not easy. Right? You know, it takes a lot of effort to turn a big boat. If you work in a big company, it's hard. If you work in a small company, it's hard because you're working on very small margins. Very small margins. These are all risks. So I say this because when we get into these spaces, they're exciting. There's also a lot of risk there. As designers, you can start thinking about our risk. Like when I build something, how do I build it to be robust to failure? What if this thing fails? We want this to be the case, but you know what? The tech's not finished being built yet. We don't know what it's even going to look like when it finishes. We think it's going to be able to do this. But in the real world, is it going to happen? Is it going to do it in every lighting condition? Is it going to do it when it's getting madly or down? Is it going to do it after I've dropped 40 times by a 12-year-old? What's this? We don't know. So we need to start to design the idea that sometimes we know that everything we think is the case might move. So you almost have to contingency plan your design. Not so much that you have to spend hours and hours designing for every alternative, but have some triggers for yourself. Know when you're close. Like if something enters that space where you know you're going to have to make a hard decision, ready to make the arms. And have people around you who you trust to help you make your decisions. One of the things I have to say is that one of the greatest gifts I've had in the last two positions I've been in, both for me and Intel, is having some people around me who I work with. When I'm in a position where I don't know, and I know I'm too close to the problem, I can get some people. Usually they don't have the same skill sets I have. You know, they might come from the business side, right? Business development. It might come from project management, it might come from a programmer, it might be a hardware guy. You know, who knows? But I run into them and I trust them. You know, over time you get to know them and you trust them. And they give you feedback, they're giving it to you because they're really just looking at a problem and just trying to answer it. And that's what you really need those people around you. Cultivate people who are willing to tell you the truth, even when you are not here. It's absolutely necessary to work in these spaces. That's another lesson there. And the last one is, let's say, keep in mind that design itself is technology. And the process of what we're actually learning, the word techne, actually is derived from the ancient Greek word that's related to carpentry, actually. Techne, design, ars, are all rooted in the same practice, which is basically solid tricking nature, you know, machines. Like they're the ways of getting us somewhere we shouldn't be able to be, you know, based upon what we have. Like we should be able to get there, and this is all we got, and yeah, we can make something that gets us there. And when you're building, we think about technology development, we're really excited about new tech when we see it, right? We see new devices, new tech, oh, this is incredible. New design is the same thing. Sometimes, to get great new design, you need to go to old design. pull up old stuff. And no matter where you're from, some of the groups, a lot of you guys are looking online to see what your different backgrounds are. It's great. People are graphic designers, action designers, all kinds of stuff. Sometimes the best interactions aren't even interactions. Right? The thing I want for a user is to not interact. I want to get rid of all the cognitive load for it. I want it to just happen. Or maybe I just want to harvest information. And something else will interact with later. This system isn't even about interacting. Maybe just a behavioral system that does what it does, and I'm just part of the ecology. And when you look at, like, when we want to find that great design, look at the guys who built what we think of as the rules, and look back at what they did before they had the new levels. Look at their early work. Look at all the stuff they did that failed. Look at how they tried crazy stuff. Like, some of my papers just looking at the early mice, like the early stuff from the mouse. It was ugly, hideous. I mean, even mouse was kind of hideous for about 20 years ago. It's only now that we're getting nice that are terribly energy to our bodies. But thinking about kind of how this happened, how this developed, can help us kind of go back and rethink ourselves. How might we take into a new space and make something that today is unimaginable? And in doing so, be ready to kill them. So basically what I want to do now is there's a lot of folks in here with very varying backgrounds. I want to kind of talk about what you're going to start with folks in robotics. We're all dealing with kind of very different stuff. So maybe talk about any questions you have, but also talk about any directions that you are interested in working or that might be possible. To kind of use this as an opportunity to have a whole future.
Thank you for the thought-provoking talk. I have two questions. One is, most of your examples came from the perspective of a user or an object that needs to do something. But it seems to me that those users are all part of the system. So like the example of the robot, the room or the environment has information. It knows whether maybe there's dirt to be cleaned up or whether it's a good time for the robot to enter. So I'd be interested in your comments on having more systemic and shared information view as opposed to, you know, just one object or user trying to get something done. And then the other question is, I work in software globalization, and so I'm interested in how you deal with the cultural and also environmental differences, you know, around the world that you would also need to support and how that shapes your thinking.
So first of all, let's take the first one. Those are two different questions, but both very good. First one, I'm with you 100% on that. I would go a different direction. I would say different. I'm hesitant to use the word systemic, not because I don't like the idea of systems.
A collection of interacting objects.
Yes, so collection. And the reason is because we get all the time, we think systems, we think we control the whole system.
Right.
But a lot of times, as we all know, we're designing for a world where there are pre-existing actors, pre-existing technology, pre-existing players, pre-existing data, and at least stuff that exists after we make this, that will leverage that too. So I would use maybe the term like ecological design, you know, really thinking about kind of designing for ecology where parts can move in and become part of it. And the other is, as you were describing, the term I use a lot for, I get very frustrated with the idea that every device needs to detect and process everything itself. Pretty false and inefficient. It's kind of crazy. So I think a lot about things like social sensing. If this room has a lot of sensors, and it's not really super secure, there's not a danger in privacy or security of certain information about it, that should be open to other things using those sensors. You know, so if, like that robot that needs to know the shape of the room and where that dirt is, that could be combined. This system could communicate to that system. The promise of IoT being actually happening, it's that networks don't allow it to happen. We don't have permissive networks. And there's a danger of permissive networks. That's why nobody wants to have permissive networks. But you can't have an Internet of Things without the things being able to communicate. And somebody needs to redesign that, agree upon those things, come up on ways of doing that. That's a huge challenge to us. So I'm with you 100% on that. That also becomes cultural to your second question, because that could be, even globally, there's cultural differences, right? And we've run into things where even the way you treat the human face is treated very, very differently in different cultures, right? So you need to think about those things. And that comes down to, they often think of, we design something that does this part and something that's, but once we start building applications of things, those are going to have a set of users. We really need to understand where it's going and who's using it. And that, I don't have a prescription for it. I think it basically comes back to just something we've talked about in testing, I think, for a long time, is ethics. Just having a good ethics of understanding where you're introducing something and what you're introducing to it. It's risky. It's always a challenge because we can't. I think there's two dangers there that I'm going to. One is we don't want to be insulting when we step in somewhere, right? To introduce something somewhere. But at the same time, we can't accept status quo as the future. So there's this challenge of where, how do we manage that? And I think it's different everywhere. That's the challenge in each of us. It's the work we do.
I just want to comment that when you're talking about the idea of somebody cleaning up a room, it's a little bit a matter of opinion. So somebody could think the room is clean and somebody else wouldn't think the room is clean. And it becomes a social consensus. And the technology or the thing about the problem of the security and the ability of our networks to be able to do it is one issue, but it's a pretty minor issue. The more major issue is, like, what are we actually doing when we do that? I mean, what are human beings doing when a group of human beings get together and we all sit there in a room and go, hey, the room is clean, and we all agree that the room is clean. We're so far from to that, isn't it? And so, I mean, I'm just making a comment on that, and I think that's where we really have a lot of work.
I think you're touching on something. We just had this conversation. It was a brainstorming session about, can't really go into the details, but I'll say emotions and robots.
And it's not just emotions. I mean, the human, we forget that there's a social layer that we ignore sometimes when we think that we're individual agents. But I can talk to you about, hey, I know what this means, and you know what this means. We have language and a theory of mind. Like I can talk to you about saying, I can say, hey, this is my cell phone, and I know that you know what that means. And so we have this shared sense of meaning that's underlying everything that we do, that we take for granted.
Yes.
And that taken for granted here, that we don't even understand.
That's actually where I was going with the emotions and robots. It's not so much the emotions, so much as what it drew out in the conversation.
Theory of mind is what they call
that. The way even we read between two individuals, humans have a very complex way of mirroring, negotiating. There's a negotiation going on in all our communication. It's amazingly sophisticated. I mean, I did it with my dog. I was talking about something. I can look at something, my dog and look out. Her ears go up and I look towards something. We realize that we're communicating. We both thought we heard something. And she decides it's my job to go act upon it now and check it out. That happens with no words. There's a really subtle social exchange happening there that's, we're occupying the same mind space there for a moment. And if we're going to talk about technology entering that space, then
sure,
it's going to be
you
hard.
Mentioned it earlier when you were talking about things that we do. Like you walk into a store, and you go into the store and you buy something. You're acting out in the play. And if you don't do the prescribed things that you're supposed to do, they're going to take you and lock you away. I mean, there is a certain prescribed, we're spending our lives going through these little scripts and plays and things like that. We don't even know what we're doing. We don't even know what they are. We've got a long way to go.
and as we get to probably see, there's a funny little, the existential poetry of Donald Rumsfeld. It's a great little book. It's basically a collection of Donald Rumsfeld books.
Where's the name of the book?
The existential poetry of Donald Rumsfeld. It's pretty funny. Yeah. There's a scene where actually Donald Rumsfeld at one point made a comment, and it really haunted me for a long time. Because that's the logic. And so he says, there are things we know that we don't know. The things we know, we know. And the things we don't know that we don't know.
Right.
And he just said three. I said, well, wait a minute, that's a there's four options there, right? What did he not say? And it was the thing that I think you're touching on right there, which is the things we don't know that we know. And those are very peculiar things, because they're the things that we believe so strongly and rely upon so strongly, it doesn't even come to our attention to question them. And those are the things that we would be happy.
Wittgenstein said, observations which no one has doubted but have escaped remarks simply because they're always being known.
I just have to add, because we think we're talking about the future, but at least 60 years ago, there was this cartoon where, I don't remember if it was Daffy Duck or some other duck, goes into a house with automated cleaning robots, and because you were talking about we don't know what's clean, this automated robot chases the duck all over the house where he's just trying to smoke a cigar or something, and the robot is like, you know, cleaning up, and eventually decides the duck is what needs to go, and it's, if you look online, I'm sure you'll find it, but that was thought of 60 years ago, and here we are today.
It's just the same question.
Like,
those
there comes that conversation touches on something you were talking about earlier that I would like. So, that interchange is not, I'm sorry, I lost my
sorry, I lost my thought.
I'm curious about the group of people that you work with. How do you get them to think this way? And especially if you're working with a client who knows their client well, and they've been doing it for a long time, so how do you get them to think in a different way?
Lorraine and I have spent many hours sitting in rooms.
Get them to drink many glasses of wine. That's the one.
I will point out something that seems intuitive and you know right away, but that I think, you know, I've experienced as a millennial, this fantastic place, which is understanding that in order to transgress in a situation like that, you need trust. And that's hard to build.
Trust from them or?
Together, with each other. And that's hard. It's really hard. If you really fix your relationship. I think in business, a lot of times we're moving very quickly and we're making just business relationships. But sometimes it takes people being willing to trust another person. And that's hard. And I think that's usually, for us, when we get to that spot, is we'll get into a place where we know. When it comes down to it, it's that guy who gets to make that decision. Of people who are he who trust him, and or who he trusts, and then before he makes that decision, does he trust the information we're giving him or what we propose? Is he willing to take that risk with us? It's not just taking the risk. You know, I'm sure you all know. There are risks I'm willing to take, and there's really risks I'm willing to take with you. If I'm going to climb a rock wall, I want to know that person I'm climbing a rock wall with, he likes to check these things. And that's, I think it really comes down to proof. It sometimes means confessing your own things, like unknown. Say, I really don't know here, but everything I have is pointing toward this. And sometimes it takes admitting that. I don't know if you, it's admit, like almost opening your own vulnerability. In order to kind of open that up. It's not a comfortable place to be sometimes in business, but sometimes that's what works. Sometimes it isn't. You really need to know the person that's in the business relationship. Wish I had a good clear reaction about it.
I think it's kind of
share their vision, and I'm going through this with the boss right now.
Yeah, so basically, you say it seems like it's come full circle, right? And that we're talking about empathy and shared empathy. He's not just a robot trying to push you out of the house. He's not trying to chase you out. He's not, you know, like, treat you like the dog. It's a clean drive you out of the house.
Just harder when the client's just a little off.
I had an example of that once with the client. And the way I got their trust was I played a dangerous card, basically. I was working at a hospital chain, and I was designing a way for them to change behavior to doctors. And they had been trying it, and anything wasn't working, and they wanted to try something new. And so they brought me, I was part of my studio I was working with at the time, they brought me in, you know, pitched to them an idea. And as I was sitting there, they're showing me the technique they normally use, and they weren't listening to anything my partners were saying previously. So as they started showing me the technique they used, it was a 12-minute video, we just sit down and watch 12 minutes of video. And I just started checking my email on my phone. And this was some execs from a chain of hospitals, and they were not accustomed to that sort of behavior. Particularly when doctors, you guys know the medical profession, there's a culture there that's very difficult to work with. And the guy asked, he turned my partner on to me, and he said, "Are we paying you for this?" And he said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, I'm not going to pay for that." And I replied, "Well, you pay all your doctors to do." And he turned to look at me kind of, "Why do you not understand what you mean by that?" "Well, if you give them blackberries," which is each blackberry, which I'm sure they did, he said, "Yes." Then all they have to do is sit down and watch a 12-minute video. That's the only thing that they really need to do. And they have a lot of work. They're all backed up. They all have rounds in there. They're all backed up on the meeting. They have 12 minutes to sit still. They're checking in now. And you just gave them the information. So this is what's happening. If you want to change that, then that's up to you to find a way to do it. And that's what we're here to talk about. If you want to talk about that, we can talk about that. But showing you what isn't working isn't going to make it work. And they got quiet, really uncomfortably quiet. And you know, this kind of uncomfortable silence. There's nobody wants to say it. And he said, "Well, what do you have to do?" And that was the door. And over time, they didn't even trust us. I'm not going to say they ended up being all gold in the end, but they trusted us enough to let us try something new. Sure.
Yeah, I have two things. One's a comment. I like what you said, that there's some things that might not have experiences in between the person and what they want, the cause that they want the world to happen. So I find myself constantly reminding my clients that the users don't actually want to use their product. They have to use their product to get the cause in the world that they want. I think that a lot of people forget about that. They try to make this landing page or whatever. It's like the user wants the thing and they would prefer that that's something in there. So kind of approach it that way until you send back. The other thing I was wondering is how often do you look at anthropological stuff or how animal systems work? One thing that came to mind is beehives and colonies. With, I'm trying to understand maybe alternative ways to have robotics connect and understand what their roles are. For example, the robot would come in and clean something, kind of judging by how maybe a beehive will determine whose role it is to do what.
So the first problem is that I think that culturally, that's a problem we all have in our products. We all want to think that everybody is just dying to use whatever we make. I think it's the great lesson of the last 100 years of capitalism is that actually needing something has very little to do with the marketplace. Being convinced that you need to do something because you're required to do something, or something else required is a huge part. Manufacturing demand is a huge part. So in that end, I think that's a hard pill to swallow, and I think sometimes, but it's a good one. So then we just go back and say, well, how do people, or just understand, where does it fit? Do they need it? Do they want it? Are we satisfying a necessary thing in their lives? Are we creating some challenges for them? Because sometimes we are. Sometimes because we're creating effort for them, but it might pay to be worth it to them because it's in satisfaction. And I think really understanding exactly what it is, where we fit in that place, is that's the A. I think that's when we talk about going from A to B, you really have to be honest about where we are. And I think sometimes that's hard because none of us want to admit that we don't have the answer that everybody loves and wants and is willing to pay anything for. So we have to accept where we are. Where do we go from there? If we don't go from there, we can't get to where we go. For me, that's the first rule of design. It's my job as a designer. It's actually my job for everybody in the company and everybody I work with to understand who it is I'm working with, to understand where they are or whatever it is in the robot, the material. I need to work with it. I need to touch it. I need to get my hands dirty there and understand what is the situation on the ground, because if we don't start there, everything else is going to be slow. Second part, I saw a guy who did some research. This is, it goes all the way back to being an undergraduate, so yes, the answer is actually multiple things. He gave an entire talk, and his talk was on bees and landmines. His title was, what? I'm so excited I got to see this talk. So I went and I sat through the whole talk, and he never mentioned landmines. He talked about, you know, tracks.
Video game investigation. Did you see that? Any patterns in terms of influencing people's
behavior? That's a huge, huge, huge question.
Did you do any publication?
So that work was done by Bauhaus, I was talking to designers who worked on that space, and some guys who did testing for Bauhaus, a very peculiar company. The way they work is very peculiar. I love them. It's the only gaming company that I just grabbed. Anything they made, all worked out. I trust them as a company, which is strange to say. When they designed that game, they were talking about the series of things they listed off to me they worked on. The list is ridiculous. And they couldn't even tell me. And they said, well, we can't tell you because it will alter. We're not revealing any of that because it will alter the experience. So they did a lot of things that were doing road testing, but it would create stress on the person purposely, and they would monitor all kinds of weird little behaviors that were happening amongst the four players to create a sort of aggregate set of metrics for what the four players as a player, what their state was in terms of, are they right at their limit? Are they past their limit? Are they breaking down? Is this too easy for them? And they would adjust all the behaviors in the system to them. Just coming back to two. So they found that there were metrics they could monitor. What tells us the metrics are? It's immensely frustrating. However, they do publish a lot of white papers, and I do recommend that anytime GDC is a gift. The gaming community still does this. The film community stopped doing it a long time ago, unfortunately. But games in the industry still believe that if one game company does well, the whole gaming industry does well. So every year at GDC, we'll give you talks where people will just pull out everything they did and do a post-mortem.
Did you see that social proof was like a pattern throughout the game?
Yeah.
And that was more motivating than as if they were the one to be assisted.
Yeah. And the other side of it was interesting too is the investment in the other people that came out of it was remarkable. Like people would. First time I played it, I played these four guys and none of us were co-located. And I saw two of them going with what they call a tank, this big threatening beast, running down the alley after two of them, and everybody screaming. You know, they all had these headsets on, and everybody screaming, "Get out of here, we're getting out of here!" We're yelling at each other. The two of us who weren't being chased were like, "Get them in the back, we gotta get these guys off of them." And the guys were screaming for help. And it was really dramatic. It was crazy. And I never felt that in the game. You know, people would look around, or during the game, you notice somebody didn't see somebody. So they crafted four different kinds of monsters and data that crafted to different kinds of players, which I thought was remarkable. One was what they called a smoker. A smoker coughs from the back. You just hear him behind you. You don't know where he's at. But there's a style of play, they people were hanging the back. You know, they let everybody else take the shots in the front, and they sit in the back and keep moving and preserve themselves that way. So the smoker was designed to grab those guys and pull them into a dark space and kill them. So it discouraged you from doing so. There was another guy that was, he would come at you, but he was still running the guy who runs and sprays everything. When you shoot him, it explodes. It explodes with this liquid. And if the liquid gets on you, when you're in its proximity, it attracts all the zombies to you. So basically, you become basically zombie. And so it discourages you from running and shooting everywhere. So it was for that guy. So he created the one's called a hunter. And the hunter tricks for the guys who are sneaking off. So they basically single off the one who gets off too far from the pack. And so they basically designed the kind of game they wanted, not by forcing you to do it, but by creating these vectors.
Consequences?
Consequences. And they used them.
Okay, so there's that self-preservation coming in.
If you guys follow the rules, stay close.
I'm sorry, what?
They'll tell you to stay close. So if somebody starts to fall behind, they say, okay, stay close. You know, like, because you need them. They want them to fall too far back, so you become afraid. You start watching everything. Really fascinating. They learned so much of that game. And I can just read their data forever. They're also the guys who did Portal. I don't know if you guys saw Portal. There's a campaign to keep in Portal, and people, like, the game is this lovable character. It was a cube with a pink heart on it. And people like, why are people so connected to this cube? But they just keep talking to you. This disembodied system just keeps telling you how important it is to keep the companion cube and take it with you. You know, to preserve the companion cube and make sure that you carry it through this whole puzzle. And at the end, they need to destroy it. You have to put it in an incinerator. And they got that from researchers, yeah, basically from people being in isolation because there are no other characters in that game, that they would apply emotion to an inanimate object. So then they basically, this is what they do. They take stuff, data from ridiculous places, and they create all these new kinds of experiences. So they give you a chance to give you the way it works.
Good.
Thank
you.
That was an amazing session. I hope you guys all have some food for thought and go to all those unknown, unthought spaces, try all the experiments, and be prepared to let go 80% of it. So that's a pretty amazing session, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. Before we leave, I wanted to introduce you guys to one more person, who is the person behind this event, a serial entrepreneur, programmer, and extremely passionate about design. Who joined Silicon Valley Designer as a co-organizer, and her name is Sophia Wickland. She wanted to make a year of design, so she's very excited to have a part of these events, design events, which we are going to host it here. So I hope to see you guys again. Some of these events, and also our host in India. So thank you all for coming tonight, and we have some more time to hang around and kind of network with each other and talk to the speaking.
I'm so sorry for his colleague that invited him. Elaine and I, for example, Intel, she is a female executive, she's very knowledgeable, so Robert, thank you so much, it's been fantastic. Really happy, glad to have you.